We want to welcome you guys to Glenville this morning, and we have a really cool video that we'd like to share with you to just tell you a little about how much we appreciate our fathers.
How important and how special it is that you're here. You know, there's probably 100 things you could be doing today, but you're here with us, and it means a lot. You don't have an easy job. Parenting comes with incredible challenges, and sometimes it's hard to know if you're doing it right. But you should know that being here right now, it's an important part. In the Old Testament, God gave this command: love the Lord your God with all of your heart, and with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. These words that I command you today should be on your heart. You should teach them diligently to your children. You should talk of them when you sit in your house or when you're walking down the street. Talk of them from the time you get up in the morning to when you fall asleep at night. So, what does it mean to be a good father? It means loving God with all of your heart, soul, and might, and teaching your kids to do the same. And what an amazing example it is that you're here in the house of God, in the presence of other believers, seeking more of Jesus and worshiping unashamed. The young men and women here see you. The kids are watching, and as they grow, they'll remember and do the same. So thank you, dads. Thank you for your presence and example. We pray that God will bless you today, renew your spirit, and draw you closer to Him, so you can continue to be a shining influence to all those around you. Happy Father's Day.
You guys can stand with us, clap along, let's worship this morning. Come on, Glenville, you can keep the beat.
God, a firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground. As nations rise and fall, kingdoms once strong, now shaken, we trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus. You're higher, you are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher, you are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
We gotta wake y'all up this morning, come on. The least he can do is clap.
Unmatched in all your wisdom, in love, justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. We bring our expectations, our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus. Trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. You are victorious. You are victorious. victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
This awesome day, we just want to welcome you guys to Father's Day. If you're a father in this room, raise your hand. So many of us. And one of the great things about a father is he can just lift you up. And this next song talks about not only can our fathers here in the world lift us up, but the one Father up in heaven can too. Come to the water, you thirst, and you'll thirst no more. Come to the Father, you work, and you'll work no more. None all labor in vain, and to love is now, love is pouring from his hands, from his brow. Love is near, satisfies, streams of mercy flow from his side. Love is
love is here.
now we have a fun little skit for you that we're going to let you enjoy here.
Greatest TV dad of all time.
I'd say it's a toss-up between Andy Griffith, that cool dad from Friday Night Lights, and Archie Bunker.
Archie Bunker?
He's my role model.
Okay, those are good dads, but nobody beats Mr. Belvedere. That was a good dad.
He's a butler.
No, he's a dad.
No, he's not a dad. He's a butler.
He seems so patriarchal-ish. Okay, greatest memory of your dad growing up as a kid.
Oh. That's tough. I mean, there's so many of them. I remember my dad took me fishing sometimes. He taught me to play golf. And we laughed. We laughed a lot.
Here's one for the books, okay? Memory of my dad when I was a teenager, okay? I was trying to convince him that I just wanted to be an average Joe. Just let me be average, you know? And he gets all frustrated with me, and he comes into my room, and he's like, "That is the stupidest thing that I've ever heard. You're afraid if you put knowledge into your brain's going to explode and ooze out of your ear. You've got the brain damage." And then he, like, gave me a Jell-O budgesicle, and it just made all my cares go away. Steal!
That's The Cosby Show.
Huh?
Yeah. That's the episode where Theo is satisfied with being mediocre, and Cliff comes in and tells him that's not okay. That's classic Cosby.
How does my childhood and TV just enmesh so much?
Okay, I got one for you. Best advice your dad ever gave you.
Life is not a dress rehearsal. Make it count.
Your dad taught you that?
Yeah, he went into sports.
That explains so much. My dad, besides always saying, don't stand in front of an open flame while eating Mexican food, he would quote this proverb, a man of knowledge uses words with restraint. A man of understanding is even tempered.
I love that. Okay, hold on. Okay, say that again. I'm gonna record it for myself. Go.
No. I'm not gonna do that. Hey, when did you first realize your dad wasn't a superhero?
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, when we're kids, we think our dad's a superhero, right? And then we grow up and we see their faults and we realize they're just human.
Isn't that what makes a great superhero? Okay, take the ultimate superhero, Superman. He can do anything. But as soon as you get him around some little green rocks, he becomes a complete ball of crypto mush. But I think that's what makes a great superhero. He knows his flaws, he knows the kryptonite. Same way with being a dad. We know our flaws, we know what trips us up, we stay away from it, and we still defend our universe.
I guess, if you look at it that way, I guess my dad still is my hero.
Boom goes the dynamite. Swish. Ready to play some b-ball?
Yeah, give me just a minute.
I was 19 years old. I was a lost individual, and I decided to take a venture out into the world and made a lot of mistakes, met the wrong people, did drugs and alcohol, and was really lost. I got to a rock bottom where I had no job, I was homeless, and I didn't know where to turn. And I felt like I disappointed my parents, my family. And one day I broke down and called my dad and my mom. I said, "Can I come home?" Told me yes, and it was a It was a moment in my life that I thought I'd failed, but I had parents and my father who weren't afraid to open their arms, just like the prodigal son. And to this day, I came back home, and I still had some moments, and my dad looked at me one day, and he says, Joey, if you're going to live that lifestyle, you're not going to live it underneath my house or in my house. And his words had a huge impact on me to realize that I needed to change my life. And I wanted to refer back to my dad being an example to me. And it says in Titus 2:11, it says, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age. And if it weren't for my father and his example, I mean, he's not a perfect man. None of us are here. But he gave me guidance. He gave me the wisdom and the knowledge and has continued to support me in my life. And it's been an awesome thing. And I say, thank you, Dad. And if you have a father that's done that for you, I challenge you to tell him that you love him and he's an amazing person. No matter what his faults are or what he's done wrong in his life, if he's there to love you and do everything for you and to lift you up when you need to be lifted up, that's what he's there for. And I, like I said, I want to thank you, Dad, for that. This next... This next song talks about how we're not skilled to really understand things, but God will give us that wisdom, our Father in heaven. So we ask that you guys stand and sing this with us.
I am not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned.
My Savior loves, my Savior.
always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always.
Sing it one more time to Him.
My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be.
You are holy.
our God's an amazing God up in heaven. And one of the things that is just in our hearts is just an awesome thing is he opens our eyes to things that we don't see. We have scales in our eyes just like Saul did and became Paul, the greatest preacher and spreader of the word. And so open the eyes is what he does for us every single day. And if you aren't seeing things like you think you should, just reach out to him. And you'll be surprised what he does for you. So here we go.
Song. I'm pretty sure you know the words to this. So don't bother looking at the screen. We can make this song a prayer. Asking God to open the eyes of our heart. We don't have to have our eyes open. Let's join together. Pray for our fathers here on Father's Day. Pray for each other. Here we go.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Sing holy.
Open the eyes of my heart.
As you say in your word, let all who are hungry come and eat, let those who are thirsty come and drink. Lord, you invite us to drink of your rich love and your rich mercy and your Holy Spirit. Father, we want to see you. We want you to open our eyes. We ask that as we reflect on our fathers on earth, that we would reflect on you as our Father, as our provider. We ask that you guide us this week. Go before us, empower us, and lead us in Jesus' name. Amen.
I was preparing for a Father's Day service and what it was going to entail. I wanted to have a song right before a drama that brought forth the idea of Father's Day. And I've asked Janet Eldridge and her son Austin to come in and to minister to us in song, a wonderful song about fathers on this wonderful day of Father's Day. So let's make them welcome as they come in and minister.
The song talks about it's a dual meaning with our Father, our Heavenly Father, as well as our earthly father. And I was blessed to have a godly earthly father who's here today and is special to me. But he also discipled my husband as a new Christian 30 years ago, and just the godly influence that that had on his life. And then now, 20 years later, I'm able to sing and share today with my son. So I just want to encourage fathers today that your example and your influence does matter, and we just love and appreciate you today.
spins and she sways to whatever song plays without a care in the world. And I'm sitting here wearing the weight of the world on my shoulders. It's been a long day and there's still work to do. She's pulling at me saying that I need you. There's a ball at the castle and I've been invited, and I need to practice my dancing. Oh please, daddy please. So I dance with Cinderella while she's here in my arms, 'cause I know something the prince never knew. She came home today with a ring on her hand, just glowing and telling us all they had planned. She says that the wedding's still 6 months away, but I need to practice my dancing. Oh please, daddy please. So I dance with Cinderella.
Janet and the band, I appreciate you guys ministering to us. You know, on Father's Day, all kinds of different things take place, whether it's our emotion or whether it's an exciting thing because of our father. But sometimes we have some negative emotions going on Father's Day because maybe of a loss of a father. So as we look at our fathers, whether it's a positive influence or maybe sometimes an absence within our life, we still want to honor our fathers and to love them and to encourage them, to encourage us to be that father that we need to be. Sometimes on Mother's Day, The mothers get, "Oh, you're wonderful, you're awesome, and everything's great, and you're the prized possession of the world, and everybody loves a mother." And the dad's day, you get up there and you tell everybody how bad they are, and you need to do this and kick them in the booty and make them do better and better and better. And dads go, "Well, this is my day. I don't want to go to church on Father's Day if I'm going to get told what to do and how to do it and when to do it." And the wife just sitting over there giving you elbows and elbows and elbows. And you just say, "Man, I don't like church on Father's Day." Well, today, we're going to talk about the prodigal son's father. Or we could say Joe, because it's Joey's father that was the prodigal son's father. Somebody that came in and took over a boy's life. And what did we learn from the prodigal son's father? We all have a mindset of what our father should be or what we think we should be. But in Luke chapter 15, verses 11 through 31, it gives us a great story that Jesus was teaching about a man that had two sons. And this man had two sons, and the youngest of those sons went to his father, and he said, "Dad, I know that you have some resources, and I know that it is customary that when you pass away, I get half of your income, your properties. I want to know if you'll give that to me now." In today's vernacular, they were looking and said, "Dad, I know you're about ready to die. Give me some bucks." And so dad, being the guy that he was, and he had compassion for his son, he went and sold his possessions, and he gave to both of his sons his possessions. And he gave to both of his sons, the youngest son, went into a foreign country and lived a very riotous life, a very ungodly life, to a point that it was so bad that all of his monies were gone. And it came to a famine in the land, and he had no money. His friends were gone. He had no resources. He became destitute to a point he didn't have a place to live. He didn't have food to eat. He had no friends. He was alone. He was so alone, so broke, so destitute. He went and looked, and he said, "I want to hire myself out to somebody that had some resources." So he went to a farmer that had swine, and he went in and he said, "Could you hire me to take care of your swine?" And he said, "Sure." He got to the point that he was feeding the swine. He became so hungry, he desired in his heart for something, and he even desired to eat the food that he was feeding the swine. And the Bible says in Luke chapter 15, a very important phrase. It said at that point, the young man came to himself. The light bulb clicked on. He said, "What in the world am I doing? How far have I gone? Why am I in this situation? Because I am doing what I want to do. My father's servants have it better than I. I think I will go back to my father and ask him if he will hire me as his servant." A moment took place. He opened up his eyes and he realized the path that I'm going down is not the path I need to go down. So he hit a brick wall and he said, "No more." He came to himself and he said, "I am going to humbly, broken, contrite, go back and say, 'Dad, I have sinned against you. Forgive me.'" So he makes his way back to his father's house. And you know, sons, they kind of look like their dad and walk like their dad and sometimes talk like their dad. So the dad was sitting on the porch and he sees this man walking down the path. And just like a dad would know, he knows the mannerisms of his son. And he realizes it's his boy. It's his boy that has gone down a path that he has prayed for him, encouraged him, and tried to take care of him. But the boy was gone, and he sees he's coming home. The father picks up his clothes, his loins, so he could run, and runs out as far as he could get to his son. The father that did not sin fell to the ground of the boy that did sin. And the son picked him up and he said, "Father, I have sinned against you please forgive me. Please make me as one of your hired hands. And the dad looked at him face to face, and he says, go, I'm going to put a ring on your finger. I'm going to put a robe of righteousness over your back. I'm going to put shoes on your feet. I'm going to have a party for you because you were lost and now you are found. You were out and now you came home. The son looked at that and he was humbled because dad looked at him and loved him in spite of his sin. And sometimes we get to the point that we think, I've done too much, I've gone too far, Father, my church, people will never forgive me. So we just stick our head in the sand and we continue to go down that same path. But there's a point in our life that we have to come to ourselves and say, this is not right. And then when people come to themselves and they understand that they have been broken and they make their way back to God, the parallel of the prodigal son's father and Jesus is we make our way back and Jesus is standing with open arms, ready to give you the greatest forgiveness that you've ever experienced. The son, he had a party. He understood what grace was all about. He understood forgiveness. He understood I lived a lifestyle that was not pleasing to the Father, but I came back and the Father forgave me. You know what? He understood what it was like to be fallen. He understood what it's like to be forgiven. But the other brother was out in the field. You know, dad gave up the inheritance and he gave to them their portion. So the other brother was out in the field still doing his work, and he heard noise. He heard a party. He goes, I'm not invited to this party. What's the deal with that? So he asked one of his soldiers, what's going on? And one of the servants, and the servants came out, and he said, haven't you heard your brother, you know, the one that gone, that was doing all kinds of stuff? He came home, and your dad is throwing him a party. Anger build up. Why would dad throw him a party and not me a party? I didn't do anything wrong. I've been here faithfully to him. Why would he give him a party and I get to do the work? So the dad walks out to him. They have a little heart to heart. He didn't fall at his feet and say, you're forgiven. He looked at him face to face in the eyes and said, son, you don't understand. You need to understand what life is all about. Your brother was lost. He was lost to himself. He was lost to his life. He was going down a journey that he had no way of surviving. And he came to himself and he came back humbly. And I have nothing else but to wrap my arms around him, to love him because he was lost and now he's found. Those two points of the way that you perceive somebody that has fallen, that has come back to God, is the way that we're going to perceive and give out forgiveness, grace, and love. It happens all the time. So let me give you some points that go along with that story. The first one, he provided for the basic needs of his family. At the start, he just provided the basic needs for his family. He was a wealthy man, and he took care of his kids. One of the things that we as fathers, our first and biggest priority, is just to take care of our kids, to make sure they're okay. The U.S. Department of Agriculture conducts a survey, and they have determined the cost of living, the study of spending 5,000 families to find out how much it would cost to raise a child in this country, one child. The latest figures have indicated that there are a new average family of you made $60,000 a year in raising two children. The cost is about $11,972 per child. When the child gets older, it gets more expensive. By the time the teenager gets to be 16 years old, it's up to $13,253,000. And when he enters college, it will automatically go up to $223,000. For a four-year college degree, raising that child by the time he was birth through college. That's a lot of money. That's $250,000 to raise a child from birth through college. Anybody have $250,000 you want to hang out? But when God gave you that child, he didn't tell you that price tag is going to be $250,000. What he did, he gave you a heart of love for that child. And when you have a heart for that love, the basic need is that you are just going to provide for that family. You're going to provide for your children. The second thing, he was generous beyond what could reasonably be expected. He was generous beyond what was reasonably expected. He didn't have to give to the boys the inheritance. He could say, hey, dude, I work for my stuff. You get out and work for your stuff. I'm not going to, you know, I tell everybody, I'm gonna spend my inheritance. My boys, you know what? When I die, if there's anything left over, you can go have $100. But I'm gonna spend my money. I'm not gonna let you have any money. Get a job now, boy. Now, anyway, he was generous beyond what could reasonably be expected. When the boys came to him, he saw what was needed, and he said, okay. And I believe sometimes God does that. Sometimes we ask God, our Heavenly Father, for something, and he says, okay, it's going to be your choice. I may give you an opportunity, but God knows what we're going to do with that choice or that opportunity. The Heavenly Father knew that the Son was going to go down a path that God did not want him to go down, but God knew that when he went down it, he's going to come to a point where he's going to be better because of it. We don't like that. But sometimes as parents, we have to allow our kids to go down a path guarded, loved, protected. But when they make mistakes, none like we've never made a mistake, only kids would make mistakes. But when they make a mistake, we have to come back and love them. We have to help them. We have to encourage them. He was beyond generous in what he gave to them. And then he gave his son space when it was appropriate. That's hard to do. Space. He didn't follow after his son to a foreign land, making sure his son did everything right. He did what he had to do, and he gave the child space, so when that child did make mistakes, God is the one that's going to change that child. We can pray for our kids, and we can give our kids to God. We can do everything we can to protect our kids, but sooner or later, that kid is going to drive off with some girl in the car. Sometime that kid is going to go to college. Sometime that kid is not going to be under your protection. You cannot put your thumb on your children 24/7. You're going to have to rely on God. You're going to have to give your child to God, give that child space and say, my child is yours. If he comes back, I may give him a whooping, but I guarantee you, I have to give space, and I pray that what I did from the time that he was born to the time that I give him freedom, that I instilled within his heart the ability, the love, and the character to follow after the instructions that I gave to him. Here are those instructions. Gary Izzo says that there are four stages of parenting. The first stage is discipline. And this goes from birth to about 5 years of age. The no's and the yeses. The yes, you can, no, you can't. Don't stick the fork in the light socket. They don't understand, but they have to be. I mean, if you say, okay, just go ahead and do that. They may learn, but they may get hurt by doing it. And we can protect our children. And that first stage is that first 5 years of life is that yes, no, discipline teaches right and wrong. And if we don't teach them in the first 5 years, what happens when they go into kindergarten and school and they have no discipline at home? What happens to the teachers? They have no discipline at the schoolhouse, and they make the lives of the teachers and the other students miserable, and they can very easily see who has discipline at home and who does not. That first 5 years is the discipline stage. The second stage is the training stage. The training stage, the follow me stage, the do it with me stage, the hey, let's go out and mow the yard stage, let's go out and paint, let's go out and fish, let's go out and camp, let me show you. It's the training stage, the monkey see, monkey do mindset. They will follow you. So, and that's the ages of 6 to 12. And then ages 13 to 19 is the coaching stage, the coaching stage. The idea of a coach is to prepare the team for the game. Prepare the team for the game. The idea of the coach is not to just yell at the kids. The idea of the coach is to say, we have an ultimate goal in mind. First day of practice is today. Our first game is in 3 months. So you have to assume these kids don't know anything about the game. So you have to take them, what does the out of bounds mean? What's the goal mean? What's the shot? What does it look like? You have to prepare every phase of life or the game. So when they get on the court or on the field, the coach is not on the field. The coach is on the sideline, but the player is on the field. When our kids turn 18 and they go off to college, if we haven't coached them correctly, they are going to get in the game. What do I do? And the coaches say, I told you. I tried to show you. But if we don't do our job, the kids won't do their job. The part of the coaching is so important to motivate, to encourage, to love, to give them opportunity, and to give them training. And then the last stage is friendship. This time, around 20 years old, through the rest of your life, become friends. That's a sweet stage. Become friends. Talk about stuff. If they need discipline, you lovingly give them discipline and give them advice. But you became that friend to them, and it's very important. So the last phase that we as fathers have to have in the growing up years is we have to give to our kids the ability to be friends. We have to give up parental and gain friendship. And when we do that, I believe it's a sweet time within our family's life. And then he was willing to forgive, number four, he was willing to forgive a serious offense and move on. I believe this point for parents, it's paramount that we have to love our kids, but our kids have to know that their parents will forgive them and move on. It's easy to say, you're forgiven. But to forgive, to celebrate, and move on is unbelievable. To go through a catastrophe in life, to go through pain, and your kids come to you, maybe it's a parent coming to the child and say, I understand. I love you. I forgive you. The weight of the world comes off their shoulders. The fear of rejection is gone because they need to know that Dad loves them. He may not like everything that you do, but he loves you. And he's willing to forgive you and move on with you. We have to get to that point. The prodigal son's father, he probably didn't know everything his son did, but he loved him. And he came to him, and he fell to his feet, and he put a ring on his finger, a robe on his back, shoes on his feet, and gave to him a party. And he said, my son was dead, but now he's alive. My son did some stupid things, but he came back. And I guarantee you, that son that came back in a whole different mindset. The arrogance that he left with was buried in the hog trough. He came back with a spirit of humility to say, life is not as pretty on the outside as it is on the inside. And when we go through junk within our life and the fathers forgive them, what happens? It builds a common bond. Because dads, we've made a lot of mistakes. Kids have made a lot of mistakes. And when we can love each other and help each other and encourage each other and be forgiven, I guarantee you the weight of the world will go off us and off those children. And then the last point is, I think it's very important that we look. He loved his sons equally, but though he handled them differently. We all, if you have two kids, you know that you could almost call them bipolar. I mean, they're like, what's happening here? I mean, One's like this and one's like this. And you love them, but you have to treat children differently in every circumstance, in every situation. Children are different and parents are different. Your parenting style is different. But children need love, but they also need parenting and they need direction. And each child is bent in their own way. And the Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he will not depart from it. We can look at that as train up a child. But I say, the Bible says, train up a child in the way God has created him. Passion within his soul. Train your child that what is burning within him, what he has passion for, what he has desires for, fuel it. Let him dream big dreams. Let him think big thoughts. Let him do great things because you are his parent and you are his cheerleader and you can control and you can love and you can guide. Train up a child in the way he should go. Whatever that bent is, whatever that desire is within his soul, give it all you have. I don't know how much money I spent on the dream of the NBA. I was going to be the father of the next Kobe Bryant. Guess what? I'm still broke, and he's not playing basketball in the NBA. But you know what? When he was growing up, we're playing this league, we're playing this league. I was a basketball dad. Every Friday night I went here, every Tuesday night I was there. I was on the front row, and I was cheering him on. I said, did you see that? Everybody's like, I'm here to see my kid. Shut up. And I was all excited. But I was wanting to train. I was wanting to do everything I could possibly do to make that dream become a reality. That was his bent. I didn't want to throw his cold water and say, dude, listen, you're short. You can't jump. Your last name is Thomas. You got some major issues. But in his mind, I'm better than anybody else. I'm more active. I'm a better shot. I can play better defense. And you know what? That may be so, but you know what? He's not playing in the NBA, and he had a dream. My job was to mold him to achieve what God had for him, not to throw the cold water on him, not to say, dude, I think your mom wants you to do something in the house. Why don't you go do something else? Why don't you try sewing? Why don't you try something different? Try to give him that dream. Let him be who he wants to be. He have two different children. Build within your child the bent within their soul to be the biggest coach that you could possibly be. But when issues take place, deal with them as the Holy Spirit directs you. Here's the worst parenting mistake that we ever say. This is what I did for him, so this is what I'm going to do for him. If I disciplined him this way, I have to discipline him this way. And just because one person makes a mistake, the discipline of one doesn't necessarily take the same discipline for the other. Discipline is important. Love is important. But we can't say, just because he did this, I'm going to do the same with him. The prodigal son and the older brother came home. One had a broken spirit. His father fell on his feet and forgave him, and loved him, and brought him in. The older son, that you would say didn't do anything necessarily wrong, but his arrogance and his pride said, why are you doing it for him? I've been with you this whole time. Why? What about me? Why are you giving him stuff? You already gave him his inheritance. I'm sitting here doing the work. And the father knew instinctively what to do. One needed forgiveness. One needed discipline. He said, listen, son, your brother that you love was lost, going in a way that was going to kill him. He was lost, and now he's found. Let us rejoice. Let us experience the blessing of God when one person that was lost comes back. It is a time of rejoicing. The son that was upset, he needed direction. He needed to see people through the eyes of Jesus The eyes of forgiveness, the eyes of care. Not what I get, but what do they need? But somebody that's been broken, somebody that's fallen down the wrong path and came to themselves, when they look at individuals, they can say, yeah, I understand. I don't want to tell you everything, but I know what you're talking about. I got it. They look at people with a broken heart. They restore people because they needed being restored. That's where I believe the prodigal son, the prodigal son's father, and the older brother came together. Wonderful picture of how the father restores his son, how a father directs his son. Every individual is uniquely gifted by God. He has given to us, fathers, the responsibility to look at your child, to look at your little daughter, and say, I have them for 18, 20 years. My job is to make sure they are ready for the game. Because if I have them for 18 years and they're not ready for the game, it's not their fault. They're not ready for the game. It's my fault as a coach. Because I didn't train them to know what the game looked like. But when they are trained, they know what they're doing. When I could see Tim, it's going to happen in a few years, I'm sure, but Tim's eye was giving his little daughter Erin away that I've been known since she was like in diapers. Beautiful young lady in a wedding dress, and Tim, our children's pastor, was up here, and she's gone. And I'm sure that if anybody had a daughter that has been married, wasn't it just yesterday that I brought her home from the hospital? And now some jerk is taking her away? He's not good enough for my daughter. What are you talking about? You only make $250,000 a year. You don't make enough money. You don't. No, no. But it's so fast. Our time is short. Let's be the dads and the parents that God needs us to be. Because in the future, in a blink of an eye, they're going to be gone. Our time is going to be over, and we're going to wonder, how did I do? How did I do as a dad? How did I do as a mom? And the only time will tell is, how did they do when they became a dad, when they became a mom? You may never know the impact on your child for years. All you know is what God tells you to do. Be faithful. Love them. Coach them. Encourage them. But more than anything else, love them and let them know without a doubt they can come to you with any issue. You may get wide-eyed. You may fall over. You may faint. You may say, you're not my son or you're not my daughter. You would never do that. But they need to know if they can't come to you, they're going to go to somebody else. Who do you want your children to get their advice from? You that love them, or somebody that wants something from them? We're dads. Let our girls, let our boys know without a doubt, I'm your, I love you. I want to be the prodigal father. When you come to me, my arms are going to be wide open. I'm going to love you. I'm going to talk to you. I'm going to encourage you. I may spank you. I may discipline you. I may give you some correction. But in doing that, you're going to know that I love you every step of the way. Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Dear Father, Lord, we do thank you for your love to us. And Lord, we thank you for Father's Day. And Lord, we thank you for our fathers. And Lord, the role that you've given to us to train and to equip and to love our children, to guide them and to encourage them along the way. I pray that you will give to us a blessing upon the responsibilities of being a dad. And bless our families and bless our children. Let them know that they are loved, that they can be forgiven. Let our children understand the art of brokenness, humility. Just like the prodigal son, he came to himself and realized he needed to go back to his father. Or if we are arrogant Lord, break us. Because the point of brokenness, whether it's in the hog trough or whether it's out on the field watching sheep, brokenness has to take place before enjoyment and forgiveness can take place. So, Lord, allow us to be who you want us to be, the dad, the parent, and the son, and the daughter, to glorify you in every step of our life. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Okay. Brother.